It's a disease that predominantly affects women, about 9-to-1 over males, and the average age of diagnosis is around the mid-50s. FMD is a vascular disease. The most common arteries that are affected are the arteries to the kidneys, or the renal arteries, and the arteries to the brain, that's the carotid or the vertebral arteries. The classic features of the disease involve this string of beads of the arteries, but also tortuosity, or lots of bends and curves in the artery, dilation of the artery, or aneurysm, and also dissection, which is effectively a tearing of the artery wall. But it can affect also the arteries down the arms, the arteries in the groin and in the abdomen, the arteries also inside the chest. Common symptoms of FMD can be actually nothing whatsoever, but for those who do have symptoms, some of the more common symptoms can be a whooshing sound in the ears, or called in medical terms pulsatile tinnitus, also headaches, occasional fullness and feelings in the abdomen, pains, and then also the symptoms can include manifestations such as stroke, heart attack, pain in the abdomen after eating, and other features that are consistent with a lack of blood supply to different parts of the body. So FMD probably affects 2-4% of the adult population, particularly women, but yet only about 1 in 2,000 women will actually ever have a significant problem or diagnosis made of FMD. It does rely on imaging, and particularly CT angiography or magnetic resonance imaging or MRI angiography. Also, invasive catheter angiography can be performed, but one of those modalities is typically needed to make a firm diagnosis of FMD. Ultrasound can also be used, but that is somewhat more reliant on the technical expertise of the people taking the ultrasound, and also the center and the people reporting that. So high volume centers with vascular ultrasound experience can be great at diagnosing this, but some peripheral centers that don't see a lot of patients with FMD can be a bit more problematic in making a correct diagnosis. Therefore, we tend to rely on CT angiography, MRI angiography, and ultimately sometimes catheter-based angiography for a diagnosis. There are four manifestations of the disease: the string of beads, tortuosity, aneurysm, and dissection. And whilst for tortuosity there's nothing specific we need to do, for aneurysm and dissection there are specific therapies. For aneurysms, particularly large aneurysms, we sometimes need to intervene on these and to coil them. Now, of people with FMD, only around 20% will actually have an aneurysm. But if there is an aneurysm in a critical part of the body, for example, in the brain, that may need to be intervened upon, coiled, blocked, occluded, taken out of the circulation, so that there's no risk of rupture. Thankfully, only a small proportion of women with FMD need to have these types of interventions done, but they can be absolutely life-saving. Other aneurysms in the body, for example, aneurysms in the renal arteries, can occasionally require intervention, again, to block that small chance that they might rupture and cause some kind of vascular catastrophe. A dissection is another thing that can happen in fibromuscular dysplasia. Dissections are usually managed by very specialized centers that can intervene if necessary. For example, a spontaneous coronary artery dissection, known as SCAD, can lead to heart attack. Occasionally, we'll need to intervene upon those, for example, with stenting or even bypass graft surgery procedures. But for most women with dissection, conservative management is preferred. So that is, we usually will prescribe aspirin, maybe some other therapies, carefully control the blood pressure, and try not to intervene and put stents if we can avoid it. For other women with fibromuscular dysplasia, we often will prescribe aspirin, and that's to stop blood clots that can form in those string of beads in the arteries, to stop little blood clots from flying off and causing problems. So in many women, an aspirin a day may be the only therapy, or an aspirin plus very careful medication to lower and control blood pressure. We also tend to advise people with fibromuscular dysplasia to avoid sudden acceleration and deceleration activities. And I can say I've got a number of people that had fibromuscular dysplasia or dissection events occur after car accidents and classic whiplash accidents where there's a sudden flexion of the neck due to a back ender of the car, and also very heavy bending, lifting or straining that can also occasionally be a trigger for a dissection event. FMD is now understood to be a combination of genetic and environmental factors. It's no coincidence that the arteries that are most commonly affected, the kidney arteries and the arteries to the brain, are very mobile arteries. So for example, the arteries to the brain need to be able to bend and twist every time we move our head around, and the kidney arteries go up and down as whenever we breathe in and out, the kidneys will move up and down with respiration. These factors such as movement of the artery and probably other factors such as hormones, pregnancy and other environmental cues can set up to trigger fibromuscular dysplasia or some of the fibromuscular dysplasia related events such as a spontaneous dissection. But we also understand genetics has a large role to play in fibromuscular dysplasia. Well, they're very closely related. Of people with SCAD, we can find FMD in about half. Of people with FMD, 2 or 3% will have actually reported a SCAD event. And we're increasingly understanding that the genetics that cause SCAD are very, very similar to the genetics that cause FMD. Perhaps they're not entirely the same, but there is a large degree of overlap. And it's even possible that FMD and SCAD are just differing manifestations of the same disease process. Well, unfortunately, there's not a lot of doctors around that specialise specifically in this disease. Definitely, if you're unsure, I'd seek cardiology advice or a vascular physician if that's possible. There's also a lot of information on the internet about fibromuscular dysplasia, including from the Fibromuscular Dysplasia Society of America. Just a word of warning, if you're going onto social media about fibromuscular dysplasia, people tend to post the worst stories. I had FMD, I lost a kidney, I had a stroke, never recovered, all of that sort of stuff. That's all over social media. They don't tend to put the normal cases, I had mild FMD and nothing really ever happened and I lived a happy life ever after. So just a word of warning, be aware that some of the stories on social media can be a bit skewed towards the worst outcomes.